Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you, I appreciate that. You're paying attention. Thank you. My name is Steve Kite. I have the privilege of emceeing tonight, and it's great to see everyone. If you want to go ahead and start making your way to your seats, we are going to go ahead and pray for our meal coming up here in just a minute. Well, we would like to welcome you to the third annual Coastline Women's Center Spring to Life Gala. Quick announcement before we get started is we do want to let you know that Coastline is dedicated to and honored to pray for you tonight. So if you have any kind of prayer request, there are two prayer boxes out here in the lobby area. At any time tonight, if you want to put any prayer request in there, it would be our honor to pray for you tonight. All right, so and actually to lead us in prayer for our meal is Pastor Jeff Dunn. So Jeff, you want to come on up here?
Let's pray together. God, we are so humbled to be in your presence and to just address you. And you knit every one of us together in our mother's wombs. And you invited us here tonight because we have a deep love for other babies being knit together in their mother's wombs. And we just thank you for allowing us the privilege of being a part of reaching in and blessing their lives and the lives of their mothers. And we thank you for Coastline. We thank you so much, God, for just what you're doing. And we ask in the name of Jesus that you would bless this food and bless this fellowship and bless this night. And as a result of this night, that there will be babies living and loved as a result of tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah, we want to thank the host for the wonderful meal tonight. Thank you guys very much. If you're not done, that is perfectly okay. We actually have two people that we would like to recognize who drove all the way from Columbia to be here. We actually have State Representative Heather Crawford and her husband, County Councilman Cam Crawford. If you guys will stand, we'd like to recognize you for being here tonight. Thank you guys very much for being here. As you guys continue on with your meal, feel free to do that. We actually also want to thank the volunteers and everyone who poured so much time and effort into this event. So if you would like, please do so. And also do so by watching this video.
Thankful that you are all here, and this film that we put together was just our way to thank all of our donors and supporters, all of you that are here, our volunteers and more that work so hard for this ministry. We simply couldn't do it without you, and so we just thank you. But the one that we really want to honor tonight is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the reason for it all. This ministry exists because of him and for him. These candles in this room represent his light in the world.
So guys, I just want to thank God for life and thank God for Jesus Christ who is here for us. So I want to read John chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it." So the word here that we need to understand, the word is Jesus Christ. Jesus was in the beginning, he was life, and he is the light of man shining in the darkness. And when the light is brought into the darkness has to flee.
The candles to our left represent the 12 babies that Coastline Women's Center has been able to save since the month of April.
And so our ultimate mission here at Coastline Women's Center is to save the physical lives of these babies by standing in the gap and being a voice for the voiceless. We also want to save the spiritual lives of the mothers and fathers. Who can then build strong families based on the foundation of Christ through love. That's our main goal here, guys, is love. Love for Christ and love for our community. And every day, our staff, our volunteers, and our clients come face to face with the life-altering decision for the babies and parents. We have to remember that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, or people, or organizations. Our fight is a spiritual one against the evil, the darkness, and Satan. Every day, every hour, every minute, and every second, we must stand. Stand for truth, stand for righteousness, stand for love, stand for life, and most of all, we stand for Jesus Christ.
When our clients walk through our doors, we really believe that they're walking out of darkness and into light. Tonight, I'm reminded of who walks with us daily. He is our comforter when we walk out of a counseling room with a young woman who is wanting to choose abortion at 30 weeks of pregnancy. This is so tender to my heart because this just happened this past week. And I went into the prayer room after that counseling session and I saw before the Lord. And it was He alone that comforted me through that. He is also our healer when we've made those choices in our life. No matter what we're coming from, we all have some sort of brokenness, or if we have it, one day we will. And He is the only one through His Word of God, His Word can heal us. And He has that sound, quiet, still voice that whispers to us, pray with her, say this to her. And there are so many times when we pray with our clients. Just this past week again, a client called and I answered the hotline and she was just in a tough situation. And the Lord said, just pray for her. There are so many times when we don't know what to say, but we listen to the prompting of the Holy Spirit and we're obedient to that, and that changes everything. Everything. And I began to pray with that young girl over the phone, and she just broke. She broke in tears and crying, and she says, nobody has ever asked me, could they pray for me? And I just want to say how important those questions are, how important it is to be obedient to the Lord and offer that light. These candles around the table, this cross behind me, it's all about Him. So, with Him in mind, it is with great honor that we welcome Ms. Abby Santa to the stage, and she is going to lead us in worship tonight.
Savior, precious Redeemer and Friend.
in our presence tonight. I'm pretty sure that for each one of us in here, there have been times in our lives that God has called you to do something big. You know, and I'm not talking about, you know, supersized McDonald's, but, you know, like, something big, you know, beyond us, something that we know if we did, it could only happen if God had his thumbprint on it. I believe for every person in here, God has done that for each and every one of us. Unfortunately, some of us say no. But you and I, we are here tonight because our Heavenly Father put something on the heart of two people to speak into others' life and to help them see life when they haven't seen it yet. And through that, Coastline Women's Center was born. So please help me in welcoming the founders of Coastline Women's Center, Carter and Jean Smith.
Blesses me every single time, and I could not help but think about singing that song. What a merciful Savior we do have, and that He is our greatest need. He's our client's greatest need, and I was thinking about their needs, the things that we hear on a daily basis when they walk through the doors of our ministry, and how we are able, through the Holy Spirit, to minister to them and share the love of Christ. And then I got to thinking about my own self. A time when I felt like filthy rags. A time when I was utterly broken. But let me tell you something, when a merciful Savior that she sung about reaches down and touches you and makes you whole, you are never the same. You are never the same. Blessed to share the Lord's accomplishments with you tonight. Last year when we gathered here for this event, we were seeking your support to purchase an ultrasound machine. With the helps of the Knights of Columbus and local churches and private donors for Coastline Women's Center, we raised the funds needed to get that new machine in just 9 weeks. Woo. Report that the ultrasound that we will share with you tonight is being done by that very machine. We want to sincerely thank you all because we could not do it without your help and support. And you're equally important to us and to this ministry. For 2016, we celebrate 595 client visits that walk through our doors. And 163 of those were new clients. We've had 556 spiritual discussions and discipleship. Here's the great news. We've led 8 to receive Christ as Savior. We've had 8 that have received healing through our abortion recovery program. One of those being a man. And 2 couples that have been married under our discipleship in this past year. And we've had 86 ultrasounds just since April. And again, these 12 are babies that were saved. On site, by the way, after they've seen the skin, they made the choice to carry and parent that baby. And that doesn't account for the ones that maybe left our building and came back later and decided to carry and parent that baby. So this year, we were surprised by our Lord to be given a second location in Myrtle Beach. So this will allow us to reach more clients and families with the gospel, as it is their greatest need. And as a result of that, we will see more and more lives saved. Now, I am convinced that God has done this because we are in the center of His will. I believe He is pleased with our work, and I believe there is a great movement of the Holy Spirit taking place. He has taken back the territory that the enemy has tried to claim. So many of you here tonight have contributed to this great work and the work of that Myrtle Beach location. God has quickly provided everything that we need, and it is set to open on March 31st this year. Also this year, we are continuing to grow. We are starting a new program that is part of our vision, a family education program that will, with the Lord's help, extend into our schools and community. It is our prayer that this program will turn children back to their parents and away from the world when walking through decision-making and circumstances surrounding sexual activity and unplanned pregnancies. It is our prayer that through this program, we would be allowed to educate students and families in a way that honors God. As we press on, we ask for your prayers. As Philippians 1:6 tells us, be confident of this, that he who has begun a good work in you will carry it on until completion, the day of Jesus Christ. I would like to introduce you to one of our staff members, Lisa Musso. Lisa is our ultrasound sonographer and is working behind the scenes tonight. Hey, Lisa.
Hey, Jeannie.
Hi. How are you doing back there?
We're all good back here.
Okay, wonderful. Are you ready to introduce our special surprise guest?
We are.
Okay. Hi, little one. So, Lisa, can you tell us a little bit about what you're seeing?
Well, right now, I'm just scanning a baby. It's almost 16 weeks old. It's moving around a little bit. As you can see, this part, that right there is the head. Let's see where the little guy's going.
He's hiding. Oh,
it's moving around. Let's see. There's the baby's spine. The baby's turning over right now.
There we go.
Yep, it just flipped over.
Well, Lisa, can you provide a little bit of information to our guests and tell them about the limited ultrasound that we provide?
Limited ultrasound. We are looking for three things. We're looking for a heartbeat, we're looking for a viable pregnancy in the womb, and we're looking for the gestational age. Well, it's moving all over.
Okay, all right. Well, what a blessing it is to have this tool. So Lisa, thank you so much. Thank you, Mama and Baby. Our next special guest. This past year, Miss Kenora Phillips walked through our doors. Kenora came to us like many other clients, afraid, confused, and walking through an unplanned pregnancy. She comes tonight with her mother and son to share her story. Join me in welcoming her to the stage.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm gonna try not to be so nervous. My name is Kenora Phillips. I am 24 years old, and I am now a new mother. God gave me my greatest gift on November 4th, 2016, at 4:40 a.m. Today, I learned what a true miracle really was. I say that to say this. You can have your life all planned out, but when God says no, he means just that. See, I thought I had my life all together, but I didn't. I was young and single, working at a full-time job, which was all great for me. I was just beginning to figure out what life could really offer me. Life was great. I met this really great guy and we started dating. Gradually, over time, our relationship expanded. It was only a few months in our relationship that I discovered I could be pregnant. I first denied the fact that I could potentially be pregnant. I thought nothing of the fact that I was gaining weight until one day I finally gave in to the what if. I took the pregnancy test and just to see the results were actually positive. All three tests. I immediately broke down crying in total denial. I was an emotional train wreck. Like, how could I, out of all people, be a mother? For a few weeks, I stayed in denial, so I kept it to myself. I tried gathering my thoughts as to what I wanted to do and how I would tell everyone of this shocking news. After a day's worth of this excruciating secret, I finally began speaking about it with other family members. Having a child was the last thing on my mind. I didn't even have my life totally together. I just wasn't ready to be someone's mother. I was facing the fact that I wasn't even finished with school, not even married. My then current boyfriend wasn't ready for a child, and I was dreading to tell him the news. I was not only nervous about telling him, but to also tell my mother was devastating to me. I had so many mixed emotions because I had so many people who looked up to me. I was always the golden child. So to disappoint all of those people who once stood by me was a lot to fathom. This had to be the lowest part of my life. I started considering abortion. And for me to even consider it was the most challenging part of my entire life. I felt horrible about even considering it, but I just wasn't ready emotionally or financially. I always knew an abortion was a sin because that was what I was taught and raised. So I did not only feel I failed my friends and family members, but I felt that I failed God. I wanted to kill what God blessed me with. For many weeks, I battled with the decision of keeping my child or abortion. Eventually, after speaking with friends and family, I finally built up enough courage to tell my mother. Telling her had to be the hardest thing I've ever done because my mother sacrificed a lot raising my brother and I. She always wanted us to finish school and make better of our lives. So I needed my mother's support in this decision that I was about to make. My child's father and I were not on the best terms, and I couldn't bear having a child with him. But even with all of that, I told my mother, and I told my mother that I did not want to keep the baby because I wasn't ready to be a mother. My mother sat beside me and she listened to every excuse I gave. And then she told me to read from Deuteronomy 5, verse 13, the Ten Commandments, "Thou shalt not kill." Once I finished, she preached to me. That's what she does best. I wasn't surprised about her response because that was my mother. I felt even worse to know that she did not support my decision about this abortion. So I did what, you know, was on my heart, and that was to turn to God, and I prayed to him, asking for direction. Even though I did not have many of my family's support in this decision, I was about to make the biggest decision of my life. I did my research on places who offered abortions, and I called around a few places in my local area, only to find a lot of those places were counseling centers. I continued to search, and I then came across the Coastline Women's Center. I browsed through their website, and what stood out to me the most was the abortion topic. I called and I spoke to the receptionist, and I told her I was looking to get an abortion. The receptionist, she immediately told me they did not do abortions, but they could help educate me on it in helping me with my final decision.
I then set up my appointment and I went in the next day, only to find myself in total shock when I arrived. That day, I went in with my heart and mind set on having an abortion, but this woman prayed with me. And she spoke to me from a spiritual standpoint, and she brought light to my situation. Joanne, she made such an impact on my life that day because she did not judge me or make me feel like my consideration for wanting an abortion was wrong. She was open, and that's what helped me overcome my decision. The acceptance I received from that group of women was all the motivation I needed. I continued to go to the center because it kept me emotionally stable. The constant prayers I was getting, to even the educational assistance there. They even provided me with my very first ultrasound. To see something so small and so innocent was so amazing to me. On March 30th, 2016, I made the most important decision of my life, and that was to keep my baby. Unfortunately, my child's father was unable to come to peace with my situation and my decision. I continued going to the Women's Center because I needed the spiritual support. They helped me in making the most important decisions of my life, not with only keeping my child, but to also growing more in Christ. Having my beautiful son 4 months ago and becoming a young mother, I would never choose any other way. Being a mother had to be the best decision of my life. I am now more focused than ever. Even though I am a single mother, I have gained so much more courage to accomplish any goal I have set for myself, just to show my son I did not give up. I want my son, Justin Amir, to know, even though I contemplated in making a decision in abortion, it was never about him, because he's the best decision I've ever made. I now hope to continue my visits with Coastline Women's Center and eventually volunteer in helping other women, young women, like myself, and make the best decisions of their lives too. I want to share this one thing. Recently, after one of my classes, while standing in the baby's closet at Coastline Women's Center, I received a call about a new job opportunity I was praying to get. This was a blessing from God because he knew I had just lost my job right after having Josh and right before Christmas. God answered my prayers and granted me with another one with better pay. Thank you, God. God is so amazing, and he continues to bless my family and I. In closing, I would like to say thank you, God, for allowing me to share my testimony on tonight. And I would like to thank the ladies of Coastline Women's Center for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, and God bless y'all.
Evil cannot win. Amen?
Amen?
I know we're not in church, but it's a church setting. I am a preacher. I guess I should say that. I'm just so excited on tonight because God has given us a good gift. I told Jeannie at the center, I said, you know what? I'm holding my miracle. Because when this child came to me on Easter in 2016 and said she wanted to have an abortion, I told her, I said, I can't support that. My son is sitting here, he got mad. He said, Mom, you always treat us like we're kids. You're treating her like she's a child. I said, but you know what? It's my duty as your mother and your leader to keep you out of hell and to keep you out of jail. I only have 1 minute, but while I take my seat, I just want to say this. There is none like him.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Can we give God another hand for this amazing story? Well, it is an absolute honor tonight to introduce Wendy Duke, our guest speaker. Wendy has lived her entire life in South Carolina. She currently lives in Spartanburg. She is a wife, a mother, a speaker, author of Grace in the Middle, and you will never see her wearing high heels, ever.
Isn't that correct, I believe?
Yes, that is true. Wendy's passion is to inspire people to seek God and to live out their faith with compassion and courage. 2 years ago in March of 2015, she and her daughter Savannah had an opportunity to speak at a legislative hearing that was considering passing the Pain-Capable Unborn Child Protection Act. What this legislation was, it would protect unborn babies from abortion who are capable of feeling pain. It was the voices of Wendy and her daughter Savannah that shifted the way the debates were going. And by the grace of God, that Protection Act was passed in South Carolina. Yeah. The passing of this bill now protects unborn babies in the state of South Carolina over 20 weeks. So that is amazing. Wendy and her family are a great exhibit of courage. And we are honored to have them here tonight. Both Wendy and her husband Scott left jobs of teaching and coaching some of their passions to youth passion of sports to spread the name of Jesus and the gospel throughout the world. Go to the website, see some of the stuff they do. They are absolutely amazing at what they're doing to spread the gospel. I thank you guys for that. But it is so, yeah, you guys, they are. It's amazing what happens when we just say yes to the call. It really is. Well, we are so honored to have them here tonight. And before Wendy comes up, we encourage you to watch this video.
My name is Wendy Duke, and I've just written and released a new book called Grace in the Middle, that our family wrote really in the aftermath of our daughter Savannah's birth. Savannah was born 14 years ago, and she was born without a left leg and was diagnosed with cancer a few days after her birth. I really had a crisis of faith. Maybe like some of you, we're in some really difficult circumstances and trying to figure out if God is real. I had a friend that came to the hospital room and shared with me a verse from Jeremiah 29:13 that says, "If you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you." And so in those really difficult days, I began to search for God. And it was about a year process of really difficult surgeries and hospital stays and chemotherapy and a lot of doubts and a lot of worry. God brought a lot of people into my life that helped us keep our heads up during that time. And it was in the really difficult, in the hardest places, that I really discovered who God was. God showed up for us in some amazing ways. I want you to know why I wrote this book. Because I know there are a lot of people out here who are asking the same questions. You're in the middle of difficult circumstances. You're wondering if God is real. I've got to tell you that He really is. He's really real, and He's true, and He's big. And then, so that's why we wrote this story. We wanted to share what God's done in our lives. We wanted to share with you just some really cool things that we've gotten to be a part of.
Jeannie, I did not know that she was going to show that video. It's a couple years old, and it a lot of things tonight has brought some memories up for me. But I want to go deep really fast and say that I just met Jeannie tonight, and I have been like mesmerized at how cool her pants are. Like, she is rocking those chiffon pants. But, Kenora, girl, you got it going on in that dress. And I know that's super spiritual stuff there, but we're sports people, and so I can barely dress myself. And honestly, I forgot that about the heels was in my bio, but I actually wore shoes here that had heels and went in the bathroom and took them off because I just chickened out. I was so scared I was going to trip on the stage. And there's two ladies in here that can verify that. There they are, see? Because I was standing in the bathroom just debating over it. It is my great honor to be here tonight and to speak on behalf of the Coastline Women's Center. My husband and I are also in nonprofit ministry, and we're faith-based just like Coastline Women's Center. And so we know what it's like to have, you know, to just depend on God and depend on the people of God and depend on people who are like-minded to do what it is that God's called you to do. And it's such a walk of faith, such a privilege to be able to serve in that way. And it's a privilege for me to be able to come alongside Coastline tonight. And I hope that my story, it will encourage you, but that it will motivate you and move you to do what's been done for me right here in your community. As Steve was explaining earlier, we were coaches, high school basketball coaches and teachers. I planned sports. I'm the oldest of three girls, and so my dad just decided that he would just teach us all what he would have taught a boy. So we cut wood and cut grass and shot basketball and learned how to throw a football and all those things. And so that's why I don't know how to wear heels or dress myself. But I met a young man at Fellowship of Christian Athletes in college who didn't care about high heels. He liked high tops better, just like me. And so Scott and I met and got married a couple of years later and started teaching. And I was not one of those women who just all their life wanted to be a mother. I'm just gonna be transparent about that. I didn't play with baby dolls really, and I didn't like to hold other people's babies because I just didn't know what to do with them. And they scared me because I'm a little bit clumsy. And so I just was not, that was just not something that was a real desire in my heart. But after my husband and I had been married for a couple of years, we discovered that we were pregnant. And it was terrifying for one thing, but it was exciting. We were married, we were young. We were not afraid, except that we didn't know what we were doing as parents. But when we went for our first checkup, and this is why this has brought back a mixture of feelings for me tonight, but we, in the very first checkup, we discovered that the baby had no heartbeat and should have at that time. And so we had our first miscarriage in our first 2 years of marriage, which was tough. And the next year we had another miscarriage, and the next year we had another. And my relationship with God had been based on, frankly, a culture. I grew up with parents who were believers, and I was in church all the time, and I was involved in youth group, but I had really prided myself in my abilities, in my athletic ability, in my education, just in myself. And so I had stepped away in a lot of ways from my faith. I believed that God was true. I believed in Jesus, but there's a difference between believing in Him and knowing Him. And I did not have a relationship with Jesus. And so during that time, I was angry. I think it's the same sort of feeling when you discover you're pregnant and maybe you're unmarried. Why would God allow this to happen to me? Why would God allow us to be in this situation? And so I really struggled through those years. And then in 2000, we became pregnant for the fourth time. And we had made it to the 20-week mark. So we went in for our first ultrasound. We feel like we're kind of in the clear at this point. And during that first ultrasound, the technician was, she was kind of oohing and aahing over the baby, and she was, you know, having us, the baby had a little, a curve in her pinky finger, and so we discovered that my husband has a curve in his pinky finger too, and he's pretty much been wrapped around hers since that moment. But a few minutes later, the technician's mood changed, and I just, in my gut, I knew that something was wrong. And I finally said, "Is something wrong with the baby?" And she began to cry. I'm sure that's not any medical training anywhere. But she was just overcome with emotion. She said, "I don't know how to tell you this, but baby only has one leg." And she excused herself, and Scott and I were left there in a room thinking, this is the cruelest joke ever. What is happening here? And the doctor came in a few minutes later, and he started to go back over the ultrasound and check behind the technician, and he said, "I'd like for you to come into my office with me." And he began to immediately explain all of the risk, all of the potential disasters that could come out of this, that her leg had not formed, that she also has cysts on her brain, that this could be an indication of chromosomal disorders, some life-threatening diseases. And he began to kind of lay out this dismal, terrible future for our baby. And he told us about how many marriages fall apart, frankly, in the stress of having a child with disabilities, in the stress of having a child that has medical problems after birth. And his words of comfort to us, his solution, his best option for us was to say, "You're young and you're both healthy, and I think your best option is just to start fresh. This will be a very quick procedure. We could terminate the pregnancy within the next week, and you could begin to heal, and you could have another baby this year." And the weight of that was just heavy in that room. My husband and I knew that morally this was not a choice we should even consider. But as a very young woman, I sat in that chair and I listened to every word he said. And I thought, is it even responsible for us to take this kind of chance? The Bible says that the tongue or words have the power of life and death. And his words that day made me consider death. It brought death to my confidence. It brought death to hope for me. But I had someone standing beside me that I'm very grateful for, because my husband, at 26 years old, he stood up and he said, "Doctor, I appreciate your opinion, but this is not an option for us. We'll have an amniocentesis next week, as you suggested, because we want to know how to be prepared for this baby's birth. But you need to know that this baby's not just ours, she's God's."
Amen.
And he took me by the hand and he led me out that door. But that doctor had planted some seeds of doubt for me, and I was scared to death. And so when I hear stories of young women sitting outside of clinics, of abortion clinics, and they're wrestling with, "Can I do this? I just want everything to be normal. I just want it to go back the way it was." I get it. I have a lot of compassion for women, because there are very few voices saying, "You can do this. You are capable, and God will not leave you." And so for those next 4 months, I struggled. And we prayed, and we prayed, and we prayed, but my heart was very cold towards God. When our daughter was born in September of 2000, she indeed only had one leg. Her left leg was only about a quarter of the size it should have been. But in the next week or so, we also discovered that the reason that her leg had not grown was was a tumor, and it was malignant. And so our week-old baby had cancer. And I can just remember sitting in that, when the doctor came in to give us that news after the biopsy, he said, I'm so sorry, but the tumor's malignant, and we're gonna need to start chemotherapy within the next few days. And when he walked out of that room, I just, at the top of my lungs, I shouted, where is God? Where is God? Over those next few months, as you heard in the video, there were people that God put in my life, people that came alongside of us, people who spoke encouragement, people who came and fed our dog for us while we were in the hospital, cut our grass for us, people who just were the hands and feet of God. They just did the hard things for us, the things that they were never going to get credit for. It was never going to be, nobody was ever going to acknowledge them for it. They're not any stars in Sunday school for it. They were just doing the good things to help somebody raise a child. And it was during that time, for the first year, we were in and out of hospitals. And at the end, right before her last surgery, there was this moment where a last doctor came in and shared with us that when they took the tumor out the next day, we were at Cincinnati Children's Hospital, when we took the tumor out, that there was a strong possibility that she would be paralyzed, that it had grown into her spine, that she would not only not be able to walk with one leg, but she probably wouldn't be able to use her other leg either. And I just got up and I walked to the end of the hallway, and I stood there for a very long time looking out into a dark parking lot. And eventually I just came to this point where the only thing I know to say is that I came to the end of myself. And I said, God, I don't even know if you're real, but if you are, I need you. You can have my whole life. You can have anything you want of me, but we need you. And I felt for the first time as if big chunks of armor fell off of me. That the weight of trying to be strong and trying to take care of everything myself, and the pride I carried for so long and trying to be great, it just all began to fall off in pieces. And I understood freedom for the first time. And we went through a major surgery the next day, 13 hours of watching other families go in and out of a waiting room. And after 13 hours, the doctor finally came out and he said, I believe you must be a people of faith, because we got all the tumor. And she's been cancer-free for 15 years this October. She's a little bit sassy, I just gotta tell you. You can tell there she's very reserved and quiet and demure. But we've had some incredible opportunities to give hope to other people in light of this. Now, she's 16 now, and she just started driving. And I was mentioning earlier, nobody tells you when you're going to MOPS, they tell you how to raise these toddlers, but that is a piece of cake compared to teenagers, because suddenly you become the parent of a teenager and none of your jokes are funny even anymore, and you don't know anything, and you can't drive. I can't drive. I don't know the right way to go, the shortest distance to get to the places that I have driven her all of her life. But anyway, all of that to say that she is living the life she wants to live. And if I had listened to the voice who said, you don't want to take this chance, this could destroy your marriage, she's probably not going to live long. We don't get to decide that, right? We don't get to decide who somebody else can be. We don't get to say, you'll never. Because God says that anything is possible with Him. There's nothing impossible with God. So we don't get to write anybody off. We don't get to write young women who've not had someone like Scott Duke to stand beside them, and they've chosen to abort. We don't get to write them off. God is a God of redemption and restoration. And this is what people at Coastline Women's Center are doing. And I want to talk to you tonight about hard things, about doing hard things, because this is what it will take. Many of you, I can tell from the statements that have been made already and the people that I've met, many of you are believers in Jesus Christ. And you know what a blight that abortion is on our culture and on our country. And you know what is right and what is wrong, but there are so many that don't. There are so many in your neighborhoods, in your kids' schools, at the office where you work, some in your church that don't know that love. And it will take hard work to accomplish change. Hard work. When we were approached about testifying before the Senate for this bill that was passed 2 years ago, I'm going to be honest and tell you, I did not want to do it. I've never appreciated politics much, but sorry, Representative. But I just have never been very interested, let's just say that. And I didn't want to get into some big political debate or controversy. I knew that this would bring a lot of attention and some negative attention to our family, to my daughter. I didn't want to parade her around in front of people and force her into, you know, being a spokesperson for someone. So we talked about it as a family, and I was thinking all along, someone else will do this. We can pass on this. People will understand. We'd be justified. And we talked about it as a family. We prayed about it as a family, and we're just sort of quiet. We decided we're going to let God speak. And so the next day, I was in a reading plan. I was reading different parts of the Bible on different days. And I came upon the story of Esther. And if you know the story of Esther, she has become the queen, basically. She is a poor orphan girl. She is a Jew. And she has become the queen of this city, this country. She's chosen by the king. And so she's in this palace, and she's serving, and she's, you know, in this place where she's comfortable and she's safe and she's got everything she needs. She's out of the woods, right? And we were kind of there too. We're past all the medical problems. You know, I just wanted to have a normal life. Just wanted everything to be just normal, you know, for a change. And Esther is approached by, they find out that there's someone that is coming against the Jewish people in that particular place. And her uncle comes to her and says to her, "Esther, we need you to speak up for us and to go before the king." And Esther gives this whole list of reasons why she shouldn't. It's against the law, that she could die. You know, if he doesn't extend the scepter to her, then she could be killed on the spot. And this whole laundry list of reasons why she shouldn't do this. And that she would be justified in not doing this. I mean, it would be suicide. And he says this to her.
I want to read this to you.
He says to her, Mordecai says, "But if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise from another place. And who knows whether you have not come to this position of royalty for such a time as this? Relief and deliverance will come from somewhere else." And he even says, "But you will perish. You will pay the price for not being the one who speaks up. Who knows that you have not come to this position for such a time as this?" And Esther considers what he said. And I sat there reading this thinking, God has given this us the story. He has written this story in our lives, possibly so that we can help write a next chapter in somebody else's life, so that a book is not closed on a life somewhere, so that relief and deliverance comes to somebody. And Esther said, she gives her servants some instructions. Fast, pray, and she says, and then I will go to the king. Though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. And I thought, well, I guess that's kind of a clear message. And my helper came down, who was 14 at the time, and she's a little bitty thing. We're all kind of giants. My son is 13 and he's almost 6'2". I'm 5'11", my husband's 6'5", and Savannah is 5'1". For her, having one leg is not a big deal. Being 5'1 is the end of the world. So she's this little bitty thing, and she comes down one day, this day, a couple of hours after I read this passage about Esther, and she has my laptop, which she's been on for some reason. She comes down, she's got it under her hip, and she's got one crutch, and she's carrying the laptop. Like, she's usually just flying with two, but this is so important that she is just making her way down however she can. She's got this laptop, she flops it open, she says, we've got to do something about this. And I said, okay, why don't you just show me what it is? And she opened it up, and it was a website. And it was a ticker of the number of abortions that have been committed in America up to that point. And it was over 50 million. And she said, whatever it is, we've got to do something about this. And we stood before that committee on that day, and I wore heels, and it was miserable. And we were sitting there, and they questioned. We just thought we were going to kind of tell our story, and then we were going to get to sit down or leave, maybe. But no, that's not how they do these things. They have this like an amphitheater of senators who are all looking down upon everybody else. And they call each witness, one for the argument and one against the argument. And so we're listening to each person. We listen to doctors on each side give their opinions, that we listen to lawyers on both sides. And after every single one, the senators just pounce upon them like a lion on a gazelle. I mean, and just start ripping them to shreds. And I mean, the first witness, my heart is pounding out of my chest. I'm thinking, nobody prepped us for this. You just told me to share my whole story in 4 minutes. But this is not part of the plan. So every witness, we're getting a little more nervous. And we're last, of course. And I look over because I notice some movement. And Savannah's leg is just quaking. She is just quaking, and she looked at me and she said, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can do this. I said, you can. We can do this. And I just said a little prayer. We're sitting there. We're going to be called next. And I said a little prayer. I said, Lord, help us to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. And I got up and I shared the 4-minute version of my story. And they're listening to me. They're locked in. And I told them about how, when we came back for that amniocentesis, at 21 weeks, the doctor explained to us how babies instinctively move away from any foreign object. And so to not be alarmed when he placed the needle inside, but that she would shrink away from it. And sure enough, she did. She moved away from the needle, and watching it on this screen, she moved away from the needle, and then all of a sudden, it was like she turned around and said, oh, no, you're not. And she reached out, and she grabbed the shaft of that needle at 21 weeks. And the doctor said, I've never seen that happen before. And so we knew we had a feisty one on our hands. And so I told them about that. Because we were considering a bill that currently allows people to pull limb from limb those children at that stage of gestation, when they can respond to their environment, where they can reach out and touch something that enters into their room. And I told them that story, and there were several that began to cry. And I said, and our daughter, that little girl, after this doctor told us that she would probably never be able to walk, she most likely wouldn't live. I can tell you a lot about her life, but I'd just like for you to hear from her. And she got up from her seat in the back, and she moved forward on her crutches. And she came and she stood before that panel of all men who had been elected by our state, who had just ripped to shreds every single person that had walked before them to that point. And she read Psalm 139. For you created my inmost being. Before I lived a day, you had already written it in your book. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And as you read that, those men wept at their seats. Because the word has the power of life and death. And we have to speak life. We have to speak life. But it is more than just speaking. It is easy to say abortion is wrong and nobody should have an abortion. We are going to outlaw it. We don't like abortion and make that very clear. But Jesus did not come to condemn the world. He came to save the world. And as people who represent him, we have to do the hard things as he did. Where he left the comforts of home. He left his position of royalty and crammed himself into human flesh. And he came to us. He came to where we were hurting. He came to where we could not help ourselves. That is the beauty of the gospel, is that we never deserved grace, but he gave it to us anyway. And there are people in our world that they don't deserve grace, but neither do we. I do not deserve grace. And who am I to withhold it from anybody else? And so, being pro-life is more than just about being anti-abortion. It's about coming alongside people and saying, you can do this. We will help you. It is about my friend Deidre, who found out about a woman who come to the crisis pregnancy center in our town, and they contacted her and said, this woman, she has four children already, and she cannot take care of another child, and she feels like her only choice is to have an abortion. And she said, if we could find a parent, a family, to take care of this child, that she would not abort it. And so Deidre and Brian went straight there. And they are raising a little girl named, wait for it, Esther. Esther. And Esther is beautiful. She is 7 now, and she's just gorgeous. But that's what it looks like to be pro-life. It looks like the couple that I met, who he's a coach, a chaplain for the basketball team at Baylor University in Texas. And he found out, one of his players confided in him that he and his girlfriend were pregnant. This was a couple that she was getting ready to finish school and had a really bright future and a career. He had a chance to play basketball overseas. And so immediately the easiest choice for them was to have an abortion. And so he confided in them that, you know, he needed to find a place for his girlfriend. And the coach said, I want you to give me 24 hours. Just wait 24 hours and think about it. And he went home to his wife and he told him the story. And the next day, they prayed together, tried to figure out what God wanted them to do. The wife went to practice, and she waited the next day at practice until for the girlfriend to arrive. And she sat there with the girlfriend, and she said, I know you don't know me, but my husband is your boyfriend's coach, and we want to help. And so if you'll keep this baby, we'll help you. We'll help keep it during the day while you're at school. And the girl began to cry, and she said, my parents have been telling me I have to abort because I've got to finish school. And she said, why would you help me? She said, because I know God, and I know He has a plan for your life and for your baby's life. And whatever we have to do to help you get there, we'll do it. And that couple is now married, and they have both come to Christ, and their whole lives have turned around, and they have this beautiful baby now because a person, a couple, people of God came alongside, and they weren't just about the words, but they're about the action. They're about doing the hard things. My grandfather was a doctor in a very small town in the 50s. And I learned about hard things because my family has taught me. I never met my grandfather, but my dad told me this story early on, that my grandfather was the one doctor who would go into the part of town where the black people lived. And he was the only doctor who would go into that part of town. And he told them when they called him, they knew they could call Dr. Mara, that he would come when they needed him. And he said, I want you to leave the light on. I want you to leave the light on. And that'll let me know where to go. But it'll also let people know not to shoot me. That's what he said to him. Because this was a time where this was almost criminal. This was a time in the 50s where this was a risk he was taking to do the right thing. And he told my dad, who was just a boy, because he died when my dad was 13. And he said, son, sometimes doing the right thing will cost you, but it's still the right thing. It's still the right thing. My husband and I, God so radically changed our lives that we knew that He was calling us to give that kind of grace, to tell people, to use our words to bring hope to other people. And we knew of people in places in the world who didn't have pregnancy centers or churches or Christian radio stations. They'd never heard the name of Jesus before. And so we felt compelled that God had changed our lives so much, we wanted to give other people that chance. And so we've had the privilege of going to places that frankly most people won't go to. I'm going to a country in the Middle East at the end of this month to be a part of a women's sports program in one of the most heavily and staunchly Muslim countries in the world. And I'm gonna have a chance to build relationships with these women. Do you know why? Because the men in that country want to win more medals in the Olympics, and so they're finally allowing their women to participate in sports. Whatever works. But I'm having the opportunity with two other women, only three women, to go in this very difficult place. And it's going to be a little bit scary. I'm going to just tell you, it's a little bit scary. I ordered my abaya today, and I got a picture of it, and I thought, I'm going to have to hide myself while I'm there. But it's going to be worth it because these women who have been denied the right to hear the gospel, they're going to hear the gospel. They're going to see me do a very good job at what I say I'm there to do. And I'm going to teach them basketball like a boss. But I'm also going to make sure they know who gives me my strength. And we've gone into places like West Africa. And I'm going to kind of close with this story because I want it to lead into where we're going next with this night. In West Africa, in this particular part of West Africa, I was separated from my husband. Well, not separated. We were just in two different places working. And so my children were actually with him, and I was with two young college students. There were two guys. that had come on the trip with us, and we had been doing basketball all day long. We were hot and sweaty, but some of the believers in that village, and there were only a few, one of them named Jude said, I want you to come to this part of the village where these women are working because I can't talk with them. Only a woman can talk with them. Would you share the gospel with them? And I said, well, sure I would. So we go, and there are these women sitting down on the ground, and they're making shea butter. They're actually crunching it up in a, I don't know if that's the technical word, but they're grinding it up in a little bowl. And they're not even looking at me. It's the total girl thing we do, where we're just kind of not even acknowledging the other woman in the open courtyard. But right beside us, there was, what is it called? A mosque. And the call to prayer was being played out over this this building. And so these women are sitting there, and Jude, who's this very young, fiery believer, follower, disciple of Jesus, he begins to translate that I've come a very long way, and I want to tell them the story. And so through Jude, I tell them this story about how God created us in his image. And he provided everything we needed right there with him. And we were with God, and God was with us, and everything was perfect. And there was no conflict, everything was good. And then we stepped away. We did the thing that God said don't do. We didn't trust God. We thought he was holding out on us. And we stepped into what God calls sin. And it was darkness, and it was being separated from God. And in sin there is fear, and there's pain, and there's brokenness, and there is violence, and there is disrespect, and there is selfishness. And the woman in front who had the most attitude, she kind of gave me an eyebrow when I said that. And so I said, but God is merciful, and he loved us even though we were in darkness. And so he sent his son Jesus. And he sent Jesus to show us how to live, but he also sent Jesus to pay for all that we had done against God. And he sacrificed himself. He did the hardest thing. He sacrificed himself, and through that sacrifice, through his death, and through his resurrection, we can be reunited with God. And we get to start over with a clean slate. All of our sin is washed away, and we are clean. And when we ask Jesus to be our Savior, to clean us, then we begin to grow. Like, and I use the example, like the grasses out here grow towards the heavens. We begin to grow, to become more like God by following him, by listening to him, by obeying him. And we grow, and we pray, and we listen to God, and our relationship with him grows. And then when this life is over, because it will be over for everybody, those of us who have been cleaned by Jesus will return right back to that place where we are with God. And everything is perfect again. And in the middle of me telling this story, of me explaining the gospel, this man rides up 9 miles an hour on a bicycle, and he parks. He kind of skids to a stop right beside us, and he pulls out a machete, and he starts swinging it over his head and screaming at the top of his lungs. And I, honestly, I'm looking for, one, do I have my tennis shoes on? Two, which way do I go? And three, please don't let me die in front of my children. That's what I thought. I don't want to be murdered in front of my children. And Jude finally said, wait just 1 minute, Miss Wendy. And he walked over to the man, and he put his finger in his face, and he said a lot of things. I have no idea what he said. And then he came back, the man stopped, and he came back, and he said, you can continue, Miss Wendy. Okay. So I continue the story of the gospel. And so these women are sitting there, and they see Jude say that. And Jude told me afterwards, I said, Jude, you have to tell me what you said. He said, I told him, he knows who I am, and he knows where I live. But this is true, And I'm not going to let him scare these ladies from hearing truth. And if he wants to stay, he can stay and listen too. But otherwise, he's going to have to kill me. And I'm glad I did not know that until afterwards. And so as I finish telling the gospel of these women, and I know, if they choose Jesus, they are going to pay for it. It's going to cost them. I know that. And so I almost feel guilty in saying, I know this sounds foreign to you and you don't know me, but I know God loves you. And I just want to ask if any of you has the courage to follow Jesus, to say that you believe that this is true. And there were children playing back behind on kind of this little hill. And they were playing and running around behind. And when I asked that question, all the children stopped and listened to what was going to happen next. And the woman in front looked up. She looked at me first, and she looked at the man on the bicycle, still with the machete. And she stood straight up where she was. And in Jude's translation, she said, "I believe in this God. If this woman has come to this village from where she lives, and she has brought her children and risked even her children for this, then I believe that this is true. And I want to know how to follow Jesus." And when she stood up, the woman behind her stood up. And when she stood up, the woman beside her stood up. And five women stood up and looked a man that could have taken their life like that and said, "I am going to follow Jesus because this is true, whatever calls me." And those children in the background began to cheer. And they begin to jump up and down and hug each other because they never had hope before. And what they had been offered for their family was hope. And we get to do the same thing here. Women influence the next generation. There are women hurting, there are women scared, and there are women who do not think they have the ability to raise children. And we have to come alongside them and say, "Yes, you can, and yes, we will." We will come alongside with our time. We will come alongside with what we know of God. We will come alongside with our actions. We will come alongside with our finances. We will come alongside you. Because what has happened, because the alternative cannot be on our hands. It cannot be on our hands. We cannot say we are pro-life and not equip people to be able to raise lives. And so here's what we're going to ask you to do right now. Courage is contagious, and there are a lot of opportunities for you, frankly, to put your money where your mouth is. I don't know another way to say that, and that seems almost disrespectful, but for us, we have to choose things. We have to choose hard things sometimes. And I know of people, I can tell you the story of a man who had saved up money. He wanted a yellow Hummer. He told us, a yellow Hummer. He had picked it out. That is what he was planning to use his savings for. And he found out about a little girl who needed to be adopted. And he said, "I had to choose. I had to choose between what I wanted, what I thought I needed, the thing that I thought I was entitled to have, and what I knew was right. Hard, but I've never regretted it," he said. He's the dad of this beautiful little girl now. And there are ways that you can come alongside and do the hard things. There is a card on your table that I'd like for you to look at. And there are several different ways. I'm going to kind of lay out for you a lot of different ways that you can come alongside. Not everybody has financial resources, but maybe you have time. Maybe you have a gift of listening. Maybe You're a man, and you can come alongside a man who's struggling with the decision his girlfriend made to have an abortion. Maybe you can sit and help disciple a young woman, a young mother who needs to know how to parent well. So here are the options and some suggestions, and anything else that God leads you, just write on that card. There's an option to make just a gift tonight, all right? So you turn in a check tonight to fund to say, yes, I'm coming alongside you, Coastline Women's Center, because I believe that what you're doing is important. Or you can make a one-time pledge. It can be just a one-time gift to the ministry tonight. The second box under there, I'm going to tell you this from somebody who helps run a nonprofit ministry. There's a monthly pledge option, and that gives them consistency, okay? That helps them know what they can count on each month, all right? That is a way that you can give them a little bit of assurance that they're going to have enough every month. So, and you can also have this drafted each month. There's a way for you to have that taken out of your, use your credit card that you can fill out there, and it'll just be deducted every month. They are asking for you to put your contact information underneath, but then there are other ways on the back. If you'll flip it over to the back, you're going to have time to kind of peruse this. I just want to point out a couple of things for the ministry. That you'll commit to praying for Women's Center. Listen, this doesn't cost you anything except a little bit of time. Some of you are prayer warriors, and they need you because they constantly have spiritual warfare. They need people coming alongside them praying. Anybody with medical experience would be such an asset to this ministry. And then there are some items underneath that if you'd like for them to contact you with any of these, if you need counseling, if you know someone who does, if you would like to be a volunteer, they need volunteers. They're opening up a new location, and they need volunteers there. It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you. And so I'm going to close with this, and I want you to just kind of, as you're filling it out, you can just kind of listen with one ear. And this has been an important lesson for me. When we first started doing ministry together, I was at home a lot, cleaning up SpaghettiOs off the floor while my husband was out gallivanting around the world, doing the glamorous ministry stuff. And so I was not sure that I wanted to pay this particular cost, that this was not a cost I wanted to have to pay. And so he left on one trip, and I was just really mad at him about it. He knew I didn't want to do this anymore. This wasn't what I had signed up for. And so he left, and during that week, right the night before he came home, my mother sent me a forwarded story on email. And I opened it. I actually opened this one. And it was a story of this little girl named Jenny. And she was at the store. She was five, and she was at the store at the checkout line with her mom. And there was, as every great store will have, little items that kids will want as you're checking out. And so she saw this little box of pearls. And she said, "Mom, please can I have these?" And she said, "Honey, you do not need those. Please, please, can I have them?" She said, "Well, you can save up birthday money or do some chores, but I'm not buying you those pearls." She saved up money. She went back and she bought the pearls, $5. She wore those pearls everywhere. She wore them everywhere except in the bath because her mom told her it would turn her neck green. So one night her daddy comes in. He sits down on the bed and he says, "Jenny, I know these are important to you, but can I have your pearls?" And she said, "Daddy, my pearls, please, you can have Barbie. She's so cool. You can have Barbie. Will you take her?" And said, "But please don't let me give up my pearls." He said, "Honey, that's okay. I'm not going to make you. I love you anyway." Next night, he came in. "Jenny, can I have your pearls?" "Daddy, please don't take my pearls. You can have My Little Pony or my American Girl doll, anything. Please don't take my pearls." He said, "That's okay. I'm not going to make you. I love you anyway." Weeks of this happening. Finally, he came in, sat down, and Jenny's little lip was quivering. And he said, honey, what is the matter? And she said, here, daddy, you can have my pearls. And the dad began to cry too. And he reached into his pocket. And he brought out this little bag of genuine pearls. The real deal pearls. And he handed her something better than what she thought was so precious and important. The thing that she wanted the most, he gave her something better. And I cried over that story because I knew that God was saying, you're wanting this safe, secure life, and I've got something better for you. And my husband came back the next day, and he brings us gifts. And he had some little dolls and toys and t-shirts and stuff for the kids. And he said, honey, I know that you already have these. And what he was referring to was a set of pearls that my mother had given me on my wedding day. And that Sunday morning, after reading that story, I went forward at the end of the service and I laid my pearls on the altar. And I said, Lord, I told you that you could have anything. And so here I am again, and I'm going to let this go again. And Scott came home. He said, I know you already have this, but I just didn't have time to shop. And so I found this little gift for you, and I hope it's okay. And he gave me this little bag. And inside was a set of genuine Asian strung pearls. And so I know that some of you probably came tonight with a figure in your head of maybe what you're going to contribute, something that's comfortable, it's not going to cost you too much. And I want you to consider more time, more prayer, maybe cashing in, maybe what you spend on Starbucks every month, give that to something that's going to matter. It will cost you, but it will be worth it. It will be worth it, my friends. There will be a few minutes here as you're filling out that card and deciding between you and God and maybe your spouse how you want to come alongside this ministry. And I just want to challenge you to let it hurt a little bit, because it will be so, so worth it one day. If you have questions, I know that there are lots of things in the back here. We're just going to kind of have a few minutes of some music and time. And I know that Jeannie and Carter will be able to answer any questions that you have, and then they will finish up in just another minute. Also, a last little thought. If you would be willing to be a table host at their dinner next year, if you would just write that on the card somewhere. They need table hosts, more table hosts, to be able to seat people. And would appreciate that.
Well, we really want to thank all of you for your time here tonight. Step a few more minutes to fill those out if you would like. We would like Pastor Larry needs to come up and close us in prayer. And as he's coming up, if you would just stay seated, we just have a couple of quick closing announcements.
Good evening. A lot to think about, more to pray about. Let's bow like the Lord's already doing together. Our Father, we have had a good evening this evening because you're a good God. Lord, none of us are here this evening because of accident. We're here because you brought us out for a purpose. And that purpose is to show your light to those around us. For we confess tonight that we are not the product of random evolution. Lord, we are not even the product of our parents' biological action. But Lord, we are the product of the mind and heart of God. A sovereign creation, a sovereign God who made us the way he wanted us to. And Lord, put us into a world and time and a place for such a time as this. Lord, some may seem like they're imperfect in this world, as we all are. Lord, you have a purpose for every one of us. And Lord, even those who seem less worthy are priceless to you, because we're all children for whom our Lord Jesus Christ bled and died. We pray, Lord, you would give us a heart for the unborn, and a heart for mothers and dads who are in crisis. As we've heard tonight, Lord, we can't just be against abortion. We have to be for those who are hurting. We have to be able, as Christ did, to reach out and touch those that other people deem untouchable, and love those that other people deem unlovable. We thank you, Lord, for the ministry of Wendy Duke and her family. Lord, we pray you be with them as they travel to this Middle Eastern country in the near future. We thank you, Lord, for Jeannie and Carter, for the vision you gave them for Coastline Women's Center. And for all of us who work with them, Lord, and those who are here tonight to pray with them and to give. Lord, this is your work, and you've called us alongside to minister with you. And Lord, that's an awesome thought, an awesome responsibility. Lord, we thank you that you have done this for us. And Lord, help us tonight to see what we can do, to realize, Lord, that even our sacrifices are small compared to the sacrifice you made for us. And Lord, that even though we did not deserve grace, you gave it. Give us grace to others. Take us home safely tonight, Lord, and keep us on our minds, our hearts. Help us, Lord, to pray, to speak to our legislators, to help out in any way that we can, Lord, to further your kingdom, and to save those precious souls and those babies that you have brought into the world. Again, we thank you for Coastline Women's Center. Lord, bless it. We thank you, Lord, for the ministry they have been able to expand. We pray that even more will be saved through this ministry. Not only babies saved, but Lord, souls saved. Thank you again, Lord, for this time tonight. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen.
Well, I couldn't help but think that, I don't know, but it's not maybe a night that God is calling somebody in here to go big. We have an opportunity to say yes. So, definitely want to thank so much for everybody being here tonight. Couple of quick things. Wendy will have a table out here, so if you want to talk to Wendy, check out the book. It is available out here for you. If you participated in the silent auction, please remain in the ballroom. In just a moment, there'll be a place the winners up on the screen. You can go over and retrieve your items. And then lastly, this is really great. Could you just give a big round of applause for the people who hosted the tables here tonight? They are awesome. As our thank you to you, if you were a host at a table, you will see a centerpiece in the middle of your table. That's our gift to you. Thank you so much for what you did. It's hard to even see these things without crying. If you look at them, you'll see pictures in there. Those are all pictures of people that have been touched by the grace of God through Coastline Women's Center. So if you guys have an opportunity to take that home, those are people that God has been able to touch because so many of you say yes. So thank you guys very much. God bless you. Good night.